Surprise Comics.
The comic book market has been on a crazy ride over the past few years, with lots of significant changes to factors that influence the market. So today, we've put together a list of the top 10 best investments with all of those factors considered, and we're joined by the top 10 king, Drew, from CoMo Comics. How you doing, brother?
Hey, man. How's it going? Thanks for having me. It's exciting to do a little collab. I've been watching you for a while, so I'm happy to be here.
Of course. My pleasure, man. Yeah, I've been wanting to do this for a long time. It's always tricky to get it to come together, but we finally made it happen. This is an awesome list, you guys. Stay tuned for the whole thing because we've added interior shots of all of these monumental moments in comic book history that we're about to talk about. And if you guys are hearing about Drew and CoMo Comics for the first time, I highly recommend you go check him out and see what he's got going on over on his channel. I think after the first video you watch, you'll be like me and say, oh, okay, this guy knows his comics. This guy has a true passion for the hobby. It's a no-brainer to step him up, you guys. The content that he puts out is carefully curated, highly researched, and well-informed. It's incredible that you get his content for free, actually. You should actually consider charging for your content there, Drew.
Well, I don't know that I'm prepared for such flattery, but I will take it.
Show some love, sub them up, and in true Bryce Comics fashion, you will be entered into a giveaway for doing so. We have Amazing Very Spider-Man nice. Number 55, the Patrick Leeson webhead cover that started it all. You get the ASM 55 Patrick Gleason webhead cover in a CGC 9A, and you get a Bryce Comics hat.
Yeah,
check it out. Look at how those that book and that hat goes so good together, you guys.
I mean, it's nice that you accessorized the giveaway. That shows you care, man.
So all you have to do to enter the giveaway, guys, subscribe to both channels, comment on both videos, and like both videos. So this is a top 10 video. You're going to get 5 here on my channel, and you'll get 5 over on Drew's channel, CoMo Comics. Link down in the description. Subscribe to both channels, comment on both videos, like both videos, and you are entered to win that awesome giveaway. Also, guys, I apologize if I look a little allergies going off. I'm here in Northern California. We got fires all over the place, and there's a bunch of smoke. So
good luck to you all out there. Hang in there. Hope everything works out all right, and stay safe.
Yep. Likewise for anyone watching. Hope you guys are staying safe out there in these crazy ass times. So first off, let's cover what we mean by the term best investment. And really, it could be two things. First, it could be a safe investment with a reliable ROI. Some people would consider that to be the best investment, but it can also be an investment with a chance at a really high ROI, cold keys, if you will, books that are in a lull, but will likely bounce back with a vengeance. So in this list, you're going to get a little bit of both. And you want to kick them off here with the first one, Drew?
Definitely. This book, I know some other creators have done some content on this, and I've got to say, I absolutely agree with it. I have seen this book be $100, $150 in raw to down in the dumps where it's at right now. And I think it's going for around $40 for a high grade raw copy, which is just pitiful. Yeah, there's a lot of them out there, but it's the first appearance of Apocalypse. X-Factor 5, you get the cameo, but here, you know, that first full appearance that everybody knows and loves. And there's really not an X-Men villain that's been treated as poorly as Apocalypse as far as the movies go. Like, that movie was bad. I mean, and it's sad because if you're a kid like me, I grew up on the 90s cartoon and Apocalypse was like God tier bad guy. We all are super nostalgic for Apocalypse, Omega Red, and all those characters that were so huge in the TV show. And it really isn't reflected in the price. Right now, you're looking at a 90-day average on a 9.8 is only $551. The last sale was $550. Now, there are some, obviously, we've got some variants that are a little more valuable. If you're looking at a newsstand, 90-day average is $935, and the last sale was just over $1,000 at $1,050. Still affordable to somebody who's, you know, kind of willing to stretch into that right at four-figure mark, and it kind of depends on how much faith you want to put into the newsstand variant when you're dealing with a 75-cent price point book. But the market is clearly showing that that is the preferred variant, really. I think there's also a Canadian price variant out there that's comparable to the newsstand. So if you want to chase that, you can get double the value out of it.
I couldn't agree with you more. Definitely, in my opinion, no brainer on this one. And 1986, I think that newsstand premium is definitely justified at 1986. And it's evidenced just by the availability on the market. I mean, you just take a look at how many newsstands are there. All right. Next up, we have Amazing Spider-Man number 31 from December of 1965. This is a early ASM 12-cent double key. First appearance of Gwen Stacy and first appearance of Harry Osborn. And there, right there, I put on the screen there is the one panel that starts it all, that just you got Harry Osborn and you got Gwen Stacy there talking to Flash Thompson. I just think it's just so cool to look at the origin and think about how far those characters have come.
This book, like you said, huge double first appearance. I'll throw another name out here. It's also the first Professor Miles Warren, which I want to feel bad for the guy. His first appearance here, people tend to forget about a lot. And then also his first appearance as the Jackal gets forgotten about a lot because he gets stepped on by the Punisher. Shout out to Miles Warren, you crazy mad scientist. I love this book. It's part one of what I think is probably the best Spider-Man story ever told. Just classic early Spider-Man storytelling here on top of all the first appearances.
Yeah, for sure. And to take a look at some numbers real quick, I want to look at 6.0 and 5.0 grades because there's some bargains to be had there. The 6.0 had a sale in June of this year of $750 and a 5.0 had a sale for $779. So the 6.0 sold for less than the 5.0. So there actually could have been many reasons for that. The 6.0 may not have presented as well or something like that, but it's more likely just because there's way more copies available in these mid grades, which means that prices have more of a spread. So be patient, pay attention to auctions, and there are definitely still bargains to be had. And anytime one of these characters has any kind of announcement or news, this book's going to see a spike. So it just seems like a really good investment, early ASM 12-cent double key. All right, so sorry about that, guys. I actually lost my microphone there for a sec, but we are back. You want to hit him with the next one there, Drew?
Yeah, absolutely. If we're going to talk about the first Gwen Stacy, we might as well talk about, well, what was the last Gwen Stacy for a really long time. And that is in Amazing Spider-Man 121. This book came out in June of 1973 and has always been one of my favorite Amazing Spider-Man books. You've got a classic John Romita Sr. cover. That yellow grabs you. I've always loved it. And honestly, I think this is one of the most heartbreaking stories in all of Spider-Man's run. Also, to go along with that, I think it has the most terrifying single panel in a Marvel comic. Now, I'll admit, I'm biased. I'm a huge Green Goblin fan, so this book has always had a lot of meaning to me. But when you see that panel, when Peter realizes that Norman's off his meds again and that he's full Green Goblin mode, you know, he's had that mental break and that he knows who he is, so he's going to find Gwen, and he gets to her apartment, and you just see the pumpkin bomb sitting on her purse. That's awesome. I mean, that's all up in your head, like, oh no, what's happening? And of course it goes from bad to worse as the issue goes on. Right now, this issue, it's definitely up. I've seen this book take a pretty good increase over the last couple years, and it's always been a desirable book. But right now, you're looking at 90-day average sales for CGC 9.0s, right around the $900 mark. That said, the last sale was over $1,100, or right at $1,100. So still a lot of kind of play in that price. And 8.5 is averaging around $781 over the last 90 days. And the last sale was actually under $700. So again, there's some flexibility in these books that aren't really tied to anything major right now. Raw high-grade copies are, of course, still pretty pricey. They're going to run you around $825. And this book is readily available in mid to lower grades. And you're going to, you know, depending on where you want to land, you're going to spend a couple $100 into that mid $500-$600, depending on how nice of a copy you want. For me, this is a must-have as a Green Goblin and a Spider-Man fan. So how do you feel about it? I feel a little bad that I picked the opposite bookend of the book you got. It's a little dark. I'm sorry.
No, actually, I mean, they do go together in a sense. And I think, first death of a major character in Marvel Comics definitely a significant book. These early ASM books, when we're talking about best investments, you put ASM on there, it's justified. I love it. I think it's a great pick.
This is kind of their watershed moment where they said, okay, the Silver Age is over. We're now doing shocking and serious things. You know, we're going to kill a major character. And then it's right after this, you start seeing the anti-heroes come out, the supernatural characters start coming out. So this, to me, as a big Marvel fan, this is our Green Lantern, Green Arrow 76. You know, this is where we start taking things more seriously in the Marvel universe.
All right, next up, we have Young Avengers number one, the first series from April 2005. This is the first appearance of Kate Bishop, Patriot, Iron Lad, Hulkling, and Asgardian. Iron Lad revealed to be a variant of Kang. First team appearance of the Young Avengers. So it's super strange that there are no incentive covers for this. You've got cover A, you've got the director's cut, and you've got the Wizard World VIP edition and the Marvel Legends toy reprint, and that's it. No incentives, which is very strange for a Marvel number one. What I love about this book is oftentimes when you get a new team, those characters will have made their first appearance elsewhere, but this is one of those special keys that it's both the first team appearance and the first full for each character. So as we know, Hawkeye is set to debut on Disney Plus soon, slated for fall 2021. And that show is going to have Jeremy Renner reprise his role as Clint Barton. And he's going to be training Kate Bishop to be the new Hawkeye for the MCU. And that's going to be huge for this book. It's going to be huge for this character. And it's going to be huge for the Marvel Universe. So this book is guaranteed, without a doubt, going to see a spike when the Hawkeye series is promoted and released. And the reason this is making it on the best investment list is because that's not the end of the potential for this book. It seems very likely that the MCU is setting up a Young Avengers team. And if that comes to fruition, this book will see another spike. And then anytime something significant happens for the characters that appear in this book for the first time, this book stands to increase in value. So prices are also in a lull, if you will, for this book. We saw a peak of $1,600 in May, and now it's back down to an average price of $1,077, with the most recent sale being $922. So if you're patient, yeah, so if you're patient, you might be able to snag one at auction for cheap. And if you're looking to sell yours and you don't want to sell it for cheap, then don't send it to auction, for God's sakes. I'm really excited for this new Hawkeye show because it's going to introduce a lot of other characters and open a lot of doors for the MCU, like Echo, Maya Lopez. I can't wait to see what they're going to do with that. And now I'm going to shoot myself in the foot here.
Okay, let's do it.
I'm going to shoot myself in the foot. Look out for the newsstand edition. Okay. It's 2005. Newsstand editions of this are super rare. I mean, ultra, ultra rare. And all it is right there in the barcode box. It doesn't say direct edition. It's just the barcode. Some people might sleep on this. I've actually never even seen one.
Most
people are wise to this. The reason I say I shoot myself in the foot is I have this saved on eBay and I check it every single day. Now
everybody else does too.
I'm not going to do it anymore. You guys, good luck. If you find it, you know, just shoot me a DM on Instagram and be like, got it. And I'll be happy for you.
We're going to shift gears on you guys now. X-Men, incredibly hot from, you know, whether you're talking the 1963 number one clear up to some of the more recent first appearances. I got to say, when it comes to X-Men for me, and I'm looking for a book that is stable and just a safe haven for your investment dollars when you're talking about comics, the first book I think of is X-Men 101. And there's a couple of reasons for that. First off, this Dave Cockrum cover is absolutely gorgeous. It's probably his best in the entire new X-Men run. I realize it wasn't that long. Yeah, Giant Size One is great and all that, but this thing is beautiful. You take this awesome cover, you pair it with the first appearance of Phoenix, which is a character that goes on to have as big of an impact in the X-Men universe as any character really ever does. It's a character that we're all familiar with from the TV show, you know, the cartoon back in the 90s. And that's probably, in my opinion, the best adaptation of the Phoenix saga that's ever been told. So it's a nostalgic character for a lot of us. In my experience and setting up at shows and conventions and stuff, this book doesn't last long. As soon as you put one on the wall, somebody buys it. There's always people asking for this book because it's just so, I'm going to commit to, I'm going to say universally popular. Even if you're not an X-Men fan, this is a book that appeals to customers who want to collect, you know, Bronze Age books, because it's just one of the greats.
Then you got the first full appearance of Black Tom Cassidy as well.
Yeah, as a consolation prize, you pick up Black Tom, right? It gets glossed over, and a lot of people are aware, but some people may not. X-Men was dead, you know, a year before this book came out. There was no X-Men, basically. I mean, I think Giant Size Wanted came out, but up to that point, you were years of reprints. So to have Claremont and Cochran come along, completely reinvigorate this franchise, and come out with a character like this, it's great stuff. And we all know this is just the beginning of where they were going. But right now, 8.5 CGC copies are averaging just over $1,000 for the last 90 days. They're sitting around $1,052. The last sale, this one's way out of whack with the rest of the sales, really year to date. The last sale was for $1,496, and that was in July 2020 when we're filming this. But like I said, it's way skewed compared to the rest of the sales. So that is helping drag that 90-day average up over $1,000. You take a look, though, it may be where this book is heading, because 8.0 copies are averaging $961 over the last 90 days. And the last sale of an 8.0 was $1,190. So I don't know if we're just in this, and that was also this month. So I don't know if there's just a bit of Phoenix fervor right now. It's hot outside. Everybody thinks a character draped in fire is appealing. I don't know. High grade raw copies are also going to run you in that same $1,100 to $1,200 range, but lower grade, mid grade copies, much more affordable. It's as aesthetically pleasing of a book that you can put in your collection as there is, in my opinion.
And that definitely, you know, plays a factor, as we I think mentioned off camera. You know, if you're going to drop $1,000 on a book and you have a choice between one that has an epic cover and one that, you know, not so much, definitely helps the sales of this book. So great pick on that one. So don't forget, you guys, subscribe to both channels, comment on both videos, and you're entered to win this Amazing Spider-Man 55 Patrick Gleason webhead cover, first print, the cover that started it all, in a CGC 9.8, and the Bryce Comics hat, a little swag to go with it. Subscribe to both channels, comment on both videos, like both videos, and you're entered to win. Links down in the description. Drew, thank you so much for coming on the show, man.
Hey, man, I will see you in just a minute over on my channel, but I'm happy to be here. We got to do this again.
For sure, man. And we'll catch you guys over there. Bye. All right.
Bryce Comics.